couple of announcements before we start worship today. First of all, these stunning, stunning peonies, my absolute favorite flower, and they are so beautiful. These are actually a special gift to us today, just presented to the glory of God in loving memory of John Prescott, given by his wife, Jean. So for those of you that have some history with the congregation, that remember Jean Prescott, and you know, we're just very grateful for both John and Jean and their family, and that they chose to share those memories with us this morning. And so these beautiful symbols of life that continues to return in beauty are given by that family today. And also, I must be official. Dear members of Heidelberg, a congregational meeting will take place on Sunday, June 4th, in the Heidelberg UCC Sanctuary, that's here, immediately following the Sunday worship service. As a reminder, the quorum needed for this meeting is 10% of the congregation. So that's 10% of the members on the books must be here and stay for it to be an official quorum. And we will also be offering this as a hybrid. So members can vote via Zoom if they are unable to attend in person. So if you are a member of Heidelberg, you are all part of this beloved community. If you're here, you're family. But if your name is on the book, if you have a little membership certificate, that is your voting pass. So we have some voting logistical issues for the congregation. The purpose of this meeting is to vote on three separate items. We promise not to keep you here all day, my babies, but we do have three items that are very important. One, do any of you know Ron Ulrich? I see some hands. So Ron Ulrich is a UCC pastor who has been in leadership roles in this community for a lot of years. Well, his daughter is a wonderful, wonderful, delightful human child who has grown up in the local church and has been here for many lock-ins, running up and down the hills with Carl. And Stephanie has discerned a call to ministry. And so she is attending seminary and requested to do her internship at Heidelberg. She's very committed to justice-oriented and open and affirming ministry and wanted to be someplace she could learn about that. So we'll be voting on whether or not we will accept Stephanie as an intern. So she would be with us for the academic year of 2023-2024 for approximately 10 hours a week, where we would give her the opportunity to work with our committees, to regularly preach, get to know the congregation, take part in pastoral care, and also Christian education. So we'll be voting on whether or not we accept her as our intern. We'll also be approving some corrections for our bylaws, fixing up some language, and approving potential revisions to the building use policy. We have a no alcohol policy that is on the books. So as we've had more people requesting to use the space as an event venue for community events, we have a couple of wedding requests that want to do weddings here in the fall, but we have to tell them right now we have a no beer, no wine, no alcohol policy in the building. So we're going to be considering that as a congregation. And I am not here to sway you one way or the other, but just asking you with a little more detail, because I would love for you to be praying about that and thinking about that. You know, we have the idea of preserving this as a sacred space, and also the idea of how can we be in outreach to the community and making it a more accessible space for people to do events, to have weddings and receptions, and also to be real contributing to the economic sustainability of us keeping this building. but wanting to do that in a way that honors our traditions and our community, and you know, just making sure we think of a thoughtful way to do that. So I really ask you to be in prayer and discernment so that we can have that vote on June 4th, because this is all of our congregation. We're all in this together, and we all felt really strongly as a consistory that this was a decision we should all make together. If you have any further questions, if you'd like more details related to each item, please reach out to a consistory member. You can reach out to, if you're a consistory member, can you wave your hands in the air? Ooh, look at all those beautiful faces serving lovingly. So you can absolutely speak to any consistory members. You can always come to me, and we will absolutely answer any questions. Be in prayer, discernment, give you the information, the paperwork. You know, if you want to see Stephanie's resume and transcripts, we got them. You know, so just feel free to reach out to us. And so thank you to our wonderful vice president, the fearless and wonderfully efficient Carl Jacobs, for the verbiage of this official notification. Hashtag Team Carl. Just saying. And then also our regular adventures. So there will not be a traditional coffee hour after church today, because as we have announced, we have a mega group of UCCers descending upon us by 1 o'clock to start setting up for Jocelyn Kearse, our member of discernment for this past academic year. Her vote for approval for ordination is today at 2. So we will have not only to feed and caffeinate all these folks who will come and vote on her essays and determine whether or not to approve her, but also we need to make sure the place is clean and in shape and that they're coming in to set up all their paperwork and make sure that they have the official quorum registration and all that good stuff. So you are more than welcome to hang out, talk to your people. Please know that. But just know that our hospitality team is going to already be, well, actually, they were here before Sunday school, starting to set up. So you will see that it's starting to look pretty fabulous in the back already. But that's why we won't have a coffee hour today. And also, for those who are interested in a racial and social justice team, we have had the diversity task force that was part of the discernment process with Pastor Rick, and several folks said we're really interested in doing that work more intentionally and keeping it up. So if you have interest in being part of Heidelberg's racial and social justice team and you'd like to talk a little bit about what that might look like, after church, we'll have a very brief meeting here in the sanctuary. So just stay for about 15, 20 minutes, and we'll talk about what that might look like. Upcoming events, Pride Night at the Revs game, my friends. It's Thursday, June 15th. It's a great time. You get a free ticket if you're willing to come and help and be at the Heidelberg table, but we really need some folks that are willing to attend and come and spend some time. It's a great way that we reach people. It's a great way that we let folks know there's actually an affirming, community positive congregation in the heart of downtown. And as fabulous as we are, not everybody knows that yet. So if you are willing and able to give even a little bit of time on Thursday, June 15th in the evening, and if you want to bring some friends, if you want to bring some, bring the kids, let me know. We'll get them tickets too. Yes, my dear heart.
Just want to say, too, if you're going to purchase tickets, make sure you purchase them through the link, because you will get a discount on your ticket. You'll also get 50% of the proceeds go back to the Rainbow Road Center. So don't just call and say, hey, I want tickets to Friday. Make sure you do it online, use the link, use the code, and everybody gets a
window. Nice. So for our friends at home that could not hear that, there is a link that is in our Heidel Happenings. Use that actual link to go to the Pride Night space to buy the ticket. If you just get a regular ticket from the box office, that money is, the ticket is not discounted. And if you buy through the link, 50% of your ticket price will go to the Rainbow Rose Center, which is the LGBTQ outreach ministry center for York County. So we want to make sure that we're contributing to the Rainbow Rose Center, as well as getting a user-friendly discount. But I'm just saying, if you volunteer, you can get a ticket. Just throwing that out there. And then also, next Saturday on May 27th, we had a lot of requests to do another painted prayer workshop, or prayer painting is a meditation practice. So we did schedule one for May 27th. So Liette Monick, our artist facilitator, will be back. So we'll be in the classroom 2 to 4. You do not need to have art experience. You do not need to have any kind of expertise. We got comedians today, friends. But just feel free to come 2 to 4 this coming Saturday. Bring friends. All the supplies are provided: paintbrushes, canvas, paints, and instruction. And we will have a wonderful time doing some guided meditation and thinking about how we can have creative prayer practices and really connect with God and ourselves, just using those different methods. And then one of my personal favorite announcements: June 11th, mark your calendars and save the dates, my friends. Heidelberg is hosting the Harrisburg Gay Men's Chorus Concert at 4 p.m. Woo! Concert venue. And we have actual Heidelberg representation as rock star musicians and vocalists in the choir this year. So I anticipate seeing all of you up here with signs that just say, Mark and Bob forever. So it's just always a great time and a really fun concert, and it is free and open to the public. So again, invite friends, but just make that a special trip out. And then I have a sign-up sheet for Saturday, June 24th. Heidelberg's going on a field trip. So one of my big aha moments was I'm going to the National Great Blacks in Wax Museum in Baltimore. And my first thought was like, Black History, the Wax Museum? Are you serious right now? But being able to see these figures, learn about them, walk through periods in history as if I was really there, was an entirely different way to learn. And it is unlike anything else that I've seen anywhere in the country, where there's lots of flat art on walls and a lot of words to read. This is a way to live and experience it. And it's very friendly and interactive for teenagers, for folks that are just starting a racial justice journey, for folks that have never been to a more interactive space like this. So Carl is going to be leading the team. We're going to head down there. We will make sure you get an authentic Baltimore lunch. But it's just a really fabulous way to spend time with Heidelberg community and continue our learning around issues of racial justice. So we will get all the logistics and details to you, but rather than announcing them all from the pulpit, because I'm trying to keep announcements shorter, this sign-up sheet will be right here. And so please just come up and put your name, and if you have an email that we don't have in the book, please make sure that you put down an email where we can get in touch with you. Yes, my dear heart. Right, needing a 10% quorum for the congregational meeting to take those votes. It's about, I think, 20, 25 people. Yeah, so it's about 25 people. So we need to have about 25 people at least that are willing to stay after on June 4th so that we'll have enough quorum to get ourselves an intern. So if you can stay for a little bit, that would be wonderful. Any other announcements? Josie? So we have a table. The question was, what does it mean to volunteer at the ballpark? So up on the covered walkway, there are places to set up tables. So they will already set up a table for us. They will set up chairs for us. We bring our materials to share about Heidelberg, put them out, and just as people approach the tables, give them a little Heidel swag, talk to folks, answer questions. We'll have an email sign-up sheet and ask them, you know, if they'd like to learn more or get an outreach from a pastor or a congregation member to put their email down. It is not, you don't have to go out and swing bats. We are not out in the powering sun. It really is just kind of being a hospitable presence at the table to answer questions about Heidelberg and let folks know that we're here. And the evening begins with a pride march around the bases. So that starts a little bit before the game, so that's at 6 o'clock. And then the game is generally over by around 9, once everything is done. Sometimes a little later, because the fireworks go off outside my window. But again, if you can't stay the full time, but you could come for, say, an hour, that would be fantastic, because that gives us a chance for a break and to also have people get up and go around and greet the other tables, right? This is a chance to meet other folks. Any other announcements, stuff we got coming up for the good of the order? Is it what? Oh, yes. So we also have our annual Penn Central Conference, which is coming up on, where did it go? I had a sheet. The 9th and 10th. Yes. Oh, there it is. The 9th and 10th, and that is in Lancaster. That is for the whole region of the central Pennsylvania area. And so we need 2 delegates, especially for the voting session on the 10th. We need 2 Heidelberg people that are willing to offer up to God for all kinds of additional blessing, June 10th, to spend the day. And we recognize it's the same day as York Pride, and so a lot of our folks, you know, might be there. So if you know you are not an out under the sun Pride person, this is a great opportunity to help the Heidelberg community and to help us stay connected with the larger congregation and community of all the folks of faith that are doing this work in multiple counties. It's a fantastic way to meet people and to really get information about what are the resources out there, what are the trainings, what are the programs, what are other congregations doing that maybe Heidelberg could bring here. So it's a great recon trip for how we can get resources for what Heidelberg might be doing to really help us continue to connect with the community better. So if you are able and available, would love to have you. Please let either myself or our fearless president, Susan Newcomer, know if you're willing Saturday, June 10th, to be Heidelberg's official, one of our official representatives at the Penn Central Conference meeting. All right. Last call, my friends. Okay. Well, in that case, I invite you to center your hearts, your minds, and your spirits on this World Meditation Day. And so a blessed World Meditation Day to each of you. And let's center our hearts and minds in the menuet from the Suite Gothique. Thank you. Declare ourselves to be a Christ-centered, open, and affirming congregation, welcoming into full membership and participation in the body of Christ persons of every race, language, age, gender, sexual orientation, gender identity or gender expression, physical or mental ability, and economic or marital status. We arose today, blessed by God's creation surrounding us. Wings of breath, delight of perception, wonder of divinity, urgency of passion for justice, intimacy of relationship, eternity of soul, unconditional embrace of God. The stone barrier has been removed. The one who died teaches us that we need not fear and makes purposeful our life's path. May we live fully and commit ourselves to the Spirit's calling this day. And by popular request, I invite you to stand up, breathe into that diaphragm, and join in hymn 173. Something that we hope to be doing this summer, which is heading down to the lakeshore.
Thank you.
be seated. And now, as we remember those disciples, not rock star pastors or super educated, wealthy, or otherwise perfect in any way, and yet somehow perfectly equipped to spread the church of God, I invite us to receive our sacred story.
Today's reading of the story comes from John 17, 1 to 8, and Acts 1, 6 to 14. I want to say ahead of time that, of course, when it said the word "these words," I had to look up what they said because I'm just that kind of person. And at the end of 16, Jesus is telling the disciples to have courage as they are flung to all of the world. After Jesus had spoken these words, he looked up to heaven and said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son so that the Son may glorify you. Since you have given him authority over all people to give eternal life to all you have given him. And this eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything that you have given me is from you, for the words that you gave me, I have given to them, and they have received them, and know in truth that I came from you. And they have believed that you sent me." The next reading is from Acts 1, 6 to 14. "So when they had come together, they asked him, 'Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel?' He replied, 'It is not for you to know the times or periods that the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth.' When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going and they were gazing up towards heaven, suddenly, two men in white robes stood by them. They said, 'Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up towards heaven? This is Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven and will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven.' Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey away. When they had entered the city, they went to the room upstairs where they were staying, Peter and John and James and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus and Simon the Zealot, and Judas son of James. All these were constantly devoting themselves to prayer, together with certain women, including Mary, the mother of Jesus, as well as his brothers. May these words speak life into your spirit."
So I learned some things that I did not actually know in researching the scriptures today. One fun fact, in Germany, where Ascension Day is actually one of the largest church holidays, it is actually referred to as Himmelfahrt. That is, yes, so Blessed Himmelfahrt. But it's a pretty wild image, this idea of all of a sudden, this teacher, this very humble guy, someone who's been speaking to the public, someone who's been traveling and caring for folks, offering food and health care, and then all of a sudden, this person who was so committed to being with the people, who was being among the people, who existed in crowd and community, who was about intimate partnership and relationship, suddenly levitates into the sky? Why does this need to be here? There surely was some sort of intention to the need for this story to be preserved over the years. It was some sort of inspiration, but it feels so out of character to me. It feels very out of place in this beautiful story that, just like in our hymn, right, we have simple workers. Fishermen, women, those that are traveling, and, you know, Jesus's mother, people that are all gathering, kind of clustering in the small room where they're staying. This is not a luxury Airbnb, my friends. This is very much regular people, and there's this great emphasis that Jesus is with them and like them. And then we have these parallel texts, right, that Jesus speaks in the most humble way possible to God. Does Jesus say, "Now that I am king," right, bring out the Charlton Heston voice, "I have become king of the earth, and now I shall ascend to heaven to rule in perpetuity over all of my people." No. Yuck, gross, by the way. Jesus says, "Everything I do to show honor to the one who created me. I just want people to know you, God, to know your love, to know your kindness, to know your gifts, to know that you care for people. I just want to live out my purpose. I just want to follow your call to love individuals," and everything about what Jesus mentions. To read it, "I did the work that you gave me to do. I was with your people. They were yours. You gave them to me to teach, to care for, to accompany, to travel with, to sit and have wedding dinners with, to offer healing spaces for, to cry and laugh and journey and develop deep friendships with." And that, as the Savior, is the work that you sent me to do. To be in loving relationship that showed what the non-judgmental, eternal, unquestioning love of God looks like, lived out in this fragile and often chaos-filled human world. And then we see the disciples sharing a very similar message. Their question is not, "Okay, is it time for our promotion? Are we ready to now get big titles and be ready to put out into the world nice and fancy? We're going to go and start a church. Let's start building big fancy buildings." Because that's clearly what you came to inspire us to do, right? except that Jesus encourages them to let go of the idea of time, and that the power they receive is not in financial gift or beautiful buildings or fabulous titles. It's in receiving the gifts of the Holy Spirit that we'll talk about next week, involve things like kindness, gentleness, self-control, sense of peace, love, joy, hope, faith, gifts like healing, prophecy, prayer, discernment. This is both the fruit and the gift of the Holy Spirit, which unfortunately, for those that were more excited if they thought there was a better deal coming, has nothing to do with wealth, buildings, power, or prestige. You will be my witnesses, is instead what these disciples are told and share. To be a witness in the lands that are mentioned, not just Jerusalem, where folks that were like them existed, but in all of Judea, including Samaria, where the folks who were cut off from the Jewish community, who were told they were not welcome, lived, right? This was the rogue group of folks who'd been essentially kicked out of the community. So they're specifically being told that you are called to spend time among those who are not like you, who do not necessarily agree with you, who have beliefs that may be deeply different. You may be called to go in places that are not societally known as being fancy or even socially acceptable. You are called to be in relationship and among people with whom you may be forced to be uncomfortable outside of your familiar zone and outside of where social status resides. And tell those folks about how good God is and how much God loves. And that's when it struck me how important it is that when Jesus leaves, it is not a fancy fanfare. It is not a choir of angels. It is not even the chariot of fire that some of our prophets get in the Old Testament texts. But it is Jesus in human body. Jesus real. Jesus looking like us. Reminding us that we are to do the same work, to live in the same way, that these bodies, as arthritic as some of them may be, as broken as they may feel certain days, as achy as they may get, these are vessels capable of representing the divine in this world. Whatever your body looks like, however it feels, whatever it's able to do, that is more than enough for Jesus to shine fully through whatever it is that you have, however you come to the world, however you present yourself, whatever you offer. You can be fully and wonderfully made, entirely divine, and a powerful messenger to community in just that body. So much so, Jesus had no shame about his body, probably dusty and worn out from some traveling, and took that thing right back to heaven. There was no shedding of the body. You are not broken, less than or inferior in any way. You carry around with you right now exactly what you need to to follow in exactly the footsteps that Jesus and the apostles carried. Now, this was an important message to me this week, because I'm not going to lie, it's been a tough week. Election day, to put frankly, sucked this year. We had record low turnout, apathy, huge, folks that have absolutely given up on the ability to make a change, on difference in the system. Number of folks who are huge supporters of book bans, trans-limiting policies, got nominations to school boards across the county. It's a rough political season coming up, friends. And a lot of folks, just for existing in the bodies they exist in, are being given the message strongly that folks look at them and do not see Jesus. And our very own Jocelyn, who's going to be here today, being voted on whether or not she gets to become a pastor in God's church, she wasn't really able to focus on that this week. Because groups, hate groups, that are linked to white supremacists, anti-gay, and anti-trans activism, laws, and legislation have decided to target the Jewish Community Center because they're doing pancakes for pride on the 11th. And they were going to have a drag story hour. And it became so intense. Phone brigades, making sure that the phone lines were being called by so many people so frequently that they had to shut the phones down. The threats of violence meant that the bulk of the staff from the diversity management team had to leave the building to be safe. And the hardest decision that was made all the way up at the executive level, because the diversity team, I'm not gonna lie, they were ready to go in. Like, okay, we call in our people too. And the executive director said, we cannot guarantee the safety of this person who's coming with a book to read to kids. So we need to tell them not to come. We like policing people's bodies for some reason. Telling them that how they show up in their body, their clothes, their weight, their gender expression, their ability, limits how present Jesus can be in them. And they're wrong, friends, because that's not of God. There is nothing, there is nothing in the Bible that I have been able to find or read that was represented in the emails and the phone messages that I had to watch people I love dearly read all day, every day, this week. And that these folks are claiming that the God they know is who told them that this is the witness we're called to. Well, quite frankly, I can't say how I feel about that, because then our YouTube would get pulled down. and I would like this to stay up for our friends at home. So live folks, just know I'm editing myself strongly for you babies. I love you, Karen. So, my friends, on this Festival of the Ascension, I plead with you to remember that your body, not just your spirit, not your intellectual mind, not your wonderful gifts and talents, not all the things that reside where no one can see them, but your very body, the way you exist in the world, the way you choose to present yourself, the way that you share and connect in community, it is a reflection of Jesus in the world. It is sacred. It is holy. It is stunningly beautiful, and it is completely perfect. It is everything that you need to do what Jesus calls us to do. And I think these scriptures are very clear in that we are not called to positions of power, and we are certainly not called to positions of judgment. We are called to witness. We are called to accompaniment. We are called to journey alongside each and every person, especially the ones who are named, the ones who are outcast, the ones who are vulnerable, the ones who are not from a centered set, the ones who are outsiders in every area of society. Those are the only ones in this verse who are named. There are all 12 tribes of Judah, and instead, Jesus, apostles, you know, all of Judah, but also Samaria, also all the other areas of Judea that are not the realms of the tribes, the ones who Jesus takes the intention of naming are not the centered set who already have the power and resource that they need to ensure their own safety. It is those who are outside of it that Jesus names and claims. The same way Jesus was named and claimed by God to go to the world and share that message of God's love, because these are my people. I've been sent to them. You are the only God that many people in this world will ever meet. You are the representation. They're not going to pick up a Bible. They probably won't ever walk through these doors. But you, as you journey through your workday, as you go to the library to check out books, as you sit in your classroom at school, as you volunteer, as you practice any and everything that you do in the world, you are on a journey of witness. Are people seeing God in you? In the way that you speak? In the way that you share, in the way you practice honesty, accountability, vulnerability, transparency, in the way that you choose your words, in the way that you express compassion and empathy versus judgment and condemnation, are you being a witness of how Jesus interacted with other humans, or are you not? Because if you are not, that is not what you were called here to do. So I'm not going to give any of us a pass today, friends. Because I know I can be petty. I got it in me. And there are times that I am not the face of Jesus in the world. Or if I am, let's just say I am not a qualified representative. And so I'm challenging myself on that, because I'm seeing how many other people are absolutely claiming themselves to be ambassadors of God, representatives of Jesus. And I'm reading the words that they're saying. And I know that can't be the only contact that folks have with Christians, with followers of the way in this world. So if we are not intentionally taking the time to represent something different, then all they have is those folks. We have a responsibility, a sacred charge to loving witness, because it may be the hope that gets those couple people willing to vote, those couple people willing to run for school board, those couple people that feel accompanied and strong enough to go to a school board meeting and speak. It may be that teacher who says, you know what, I'm putting the rainbow sticker up on my door. It may be the individual who says, you know what, I'm going to reach out and give these kids a place to meet in my, you know, pizza parlor. These are all things that are actually happening. These are all things that a compassionate witness has empowered in our community. You will never know most of the good you do, but you may be that person that offers the inspiration that allows God's love and care to manifest in the world in a way that changes everything for someone who desperately needs it. So please, my friends, carry yourselves with intention as you go forth into the world this week, this month, this year, this life. Because it will be past all too soon. Amen. This, my friends, is the time that we share our gifts and our offerings with this community. So I invite you, coming from the front to the rear of the church, to let us share the overflow of our abundance of time, talent, and treasure, so that the work of God's ministry may continue to bring change and renewal in our community. Let us give generously and with loving hearts. And if your hand is full or empty, still come up. Make your pledge to go where God has called you and to share your treasure or your time or your talent as your neighbors need. And we have little bowls. If you're a visitor, there's little bowls up here next to the offering plates that hold stones and crystals and little things that you can take with you, place in your pocket, carry with you this week, just as a tangible reminder that you have strength and love for this journey, that when we give, we also receive, and that as part of God's community, we are never alone or unaccompanied, even when there are moments when it feels like we are. So again, feel free to just place your hand over the open offering plate and pledge in prayer whatever it is that you're going to do or be for someone this week. And then feel free to take something with you as a symbol of love and strength for the journey. Let us pray. O God, who makes all things new, new stars, new dust, new life, take our hearts, every hardened edge and measured beat, and create something new in us. We need your newness, God, the rough parts of us made smooth. By the power of your Spirit, turn us toward love again. Amen. Now we offer prayers at this time, and I'll begin by offering some of the prayers that folks have written down, and then this microphone is open if you would like to offer a thanksgiving, a prayer, a care or concern, anything that you are willing to share with this community so that we can pray together for you. And we even have a microphone. If you would prefer to stay seated, then the handsome and fabulous Carl will come to you with a microphone. So just wave your hand if you would prefer that to coming up to the microphone. So let us pray together. God, we offer you thanksgiving for the amazing artists in our community, particularly the very incredible art that graces our walls now that is done by our sister Heather, and in which we can see the creation and recreation of storm and the many eyes of angels. I also ask you to be with Ron and the friends of Ron, particularly baby James, who was born this morning at only 24 weeks. We ask you to wrap around baby James's parents and grandparents, all those gathered in care and concern over baby James' life. And also, God, we offer up to you the prayers, cares, and concerns and thanks and gratitudes of this community.
My dad's been on the prayer list here for all year. And he turns 90 tomorrow. And today he's having a birthday party at his church. So this is just a praise. I mean, he got up, got dressed, got out of the house. So thank you for the power of prayer.
I also have a Thanksgiving that a lot of you joined me praying for my aunt down in South Carolina, who has been living with stage 4 breast cancer for many years. And she went back in for her checkup to chart the advancement, and they said, "Well, ma'am, you appear to be in remission." For whatever reason, it appears that her cancer has stopped growing and has been holding stable for more than 6 months, which has not happened in more than 5 years. So She teases me. She is not necessarily a woman of profound faith. So she told me that it was very cute that I was doing my little pixie prayers with my friends, and thank you for those. So my aunt sends thank you for your pixie prayers. And my cousins, who are very close to me, were able to go down and visit her, and her great happy place is the beach. And she lives like 5 miles from it, and she hasn't been able to go for almost the last year. And so they were able to take her to the beach, and she was able to go. And so this morning, I got a picture from my cousin of, you know, Aunt Donnie and them sitting on the beach, watching the late sunrise. So thank you, God, for that. Any other prayers, cares, praises, or concerns? Well, then, God, we also wrap Minister Jocelyn in prayer for this afternoon's vote and meeting in tremendous gratitude for her team. Jocelyn has a pastoral team that has supervised her being in care here, and they have been so loving and attentive in reading her papers and listening to her sermons and offering her feedback and growth opportunity. So, God, we give you thanks and prayer for every blessing upon that team of mentors and nurturers, and also on our hospitality angels who are going to be caring for just all the folks of faith today and who have been doing so already. And now let us pray together as Jesus taught us. And you may use the words of an alternative version of the Lord's Prayer that are printed in the bulletin, or whatever version is most familiar and speaks to your heart. Loving God, through the Spirit's revelation, may your true nature be honored everywhere. May your reign of love come. May desire of your heart for the world be done. In us, by us, and through us, in the power of the Spirit. Give us the bread we need for each day. Forgive us. Enable us to forgive others. Keep us from all anxiety and fear. For you reign in the power that comes from love, which is your glory forever and ever. Amen.
Good morning. Today's poetry is entitled Fire by Judy Brown. What makes a fire burn is a space between the logs, a breathing space. Too much of a good thing, too many logs, packed in too tight, can douse the flames almost as surely as a pail of water would. So building fires requires attention to the spaces in between as much as to the wood. When we are able to build open spaces in the same way that we have learned to pile on the logs, then we can come to see how it is fuel and the absence of fuel together that make fire possible. We only need to lay a log lightly from time to time. A fire grows simply because the space is there, with openings in which the flame that knows just how it wants to burn can find its way.
Thank you.
I invite you to hope in God. For with God there is steadfast love, and with Jesus is great power to save. So go into the world with assurance, hope, and promise. The grace of Jesus Christ rest upon you, and the love of God, creator and giver of life, embrace you, and the transforming power of the Holy Spirit uphold you this day and all your days. Amen. Let us pass the peace. Still, you still back. Come on.
Pastor Carla did so well last week, didn't she? Uh-huh. I'm happy to have some of you also take turns, just saying. Let's send each other now out with the peace in American Sign Language. Peace. Mm-hmm. Bringing it down and bringing it back together. Be with you. And God's people say, amen.
Amen.